I haven't got time to read a paper during the week, so on Sundays it's important to me to get it right.
Interviews, definitely.
I mean, it does what all good journalism should do, which is nice.
Travel. I just sort of graze through it, you know, here and there, like a cow.
Oh, I mean, hugely. Hugely.
Travel.
I think it's a question of voice.
I think the title says it all, doesn't it? I mean, you know, Sunday, and then, well, format. Yes.
Cover story. Thrilled to death. Is media treatment of human disasters on the African continent a form of emotional pornography for the advanced world? Yes, says journalist John Boughton, who spent 3 weeks in a Rwandan refugee camp with photographer David Thomas to compile his harrowing report. Pages 4 to 23.
Bouncing Czechs. Why is it that Czechoslovakian men are so reluctant to wear underwear? Olivia Downton goes to Prague to investigate. Page 26.
Black-bottomed girl. Enfant, yes, but not so terrible after all. Luke Rainey meets Lorna Stride and goes to see her Marmite buttocks at the Tate. Page 60.
My first shoes. This week, Vikram Seth. Page 51.
Bile. This week, Steve Frampton explains why he hates gravel. Page 68.
Packing a punch. Fiona Hartley welcomes the rise and rise of the codpiece in this autumn's Paris collections. Page 70.
Measured opinion. The page where we ask people of roughly the same height for their thoughts about a different issue each week. This week, the 60s. Page 81.
Open file. Go forth and rejoice. Joyce Elliott is a priest in the Church of England. She's also a lesbian, murdered her father, and was once a man. Sarah Dunant went to meet her. Page 85.
Pure genius. Misunderstood, but at the heart of civilized life as we know it. Julie Lefebvre on tomato puree. Page...
Modus vivendi. 10 high street shops. Boots. WH Smith's. Tesco. Littlewoods. C&A. Ryman's.
10 European
John Menzies,
countries.
Asda.
France.
Toys R Us.
Sweden.
Marks and Spencer.
Wales. Greece. Latvia.
Germany. 10 lottery numbers.
Italy.
31. 17. 5. 11. 44. 16. 26. 32.
The Infinancial. Sunday format's new financial money section. Wealth and Fitness Centre. Personal income facts. Case notes.
Simon Hawkins and Charlotte Brooke.
Ages.
37 and hard to say.
Occupations.
Management consultancy analyst and interior dress designer.
Living.
Yes.
Location.
Bristol.
Incomes.
£85,000 from Simon's consultancy last year and, about £10,000 or actually probably a lot more than that, £25,000 from Charlotte's interior dress work. £40,000.
Combined total?
£85,000.
Assets?
£40,000 from a trust fund set up by Simon's grandfather and an eye for colours, because colours are really important.
Mortgage?
£154,000. Partly repayment, partly endowment, and partly just, you know, like a whole load of figures that don't mean anything.
Aims?
Increase pension provision for family protection and better conditions for farm animals, also tigers.
The last year has been a busy year for Simon and Charlotte with the arrival of their daughter Olivia, the arrival of a nanny, the conversion of the outbuildings from outbuildings to a space where Charlotte feels grounded but also in a curious way set free both as a woman and a mother, and the departure of the nanny.
Are you lonely, unhappy, a bit of a disaster socially, perhaps not exactly an oil painting? Loveline can put you in touch with someone just like you.
Eileen?
Above left
was a lonely 33-year-old schoolteacher when she joined Loveline. She had been thinking seriously about joining for about a year. Then one day, she gave up thinking altogether and joined. Barry,
above right, no, we couldn't believe it either,
had a job as a civil servant. He used to move around a lot and so found it difficult to form relationships. Then he saw a doctor who gave him a weekly prescription. So now he doesn't move around quite so much.
As soon as we met, any awkwardness disappeared. Barry was hardly moving around at all, and straight away I felt as if I'd known him for a long time, which is amazing because after a few months I had.
Just 6 weeks later, Barry asked Eileen to marry him whilst they were out jogging together. Eileen didn't much like the sound of that, so they got married in a registry office, like normal people.
I've always known I'll meet the perfect woman,
says Barry.
And now that I'm married to Eileen, I don't know what the hell will happen if I do.
I knew that Derek,
bottom right,
was the one for me after our second date,
says Brenda.
left behind.
It was just wonderful because, you know, at my age, I normally like to be in control of things, and then all of a sudden, wham, I was in control of...
Although things are okay for the moment, Simon's worried that because he's so preoccupied with the day-to-day demands of his business, and Charlotte is so preoccupied with making a bold statement about how everything is connected to everything else and about who she is at this point in her life, they may not be making an adequate level of pension provision for the future. He stresses the need to think about all possible eventualities, including scenarios where, for any reason at all, they were at some point in the future to find themselves leading separate lives, one of them perhaps with a new partner.
Alison Tither, this week's expert analyst, is a partner in Lingfield de Waterman House Board of Finch Lom and Foster.
Simon is right to be thinking about pensions at this stage in his life. He's also right when thinking about future financial provision to work on the assumption that the future will be completely unpredictable, especially if he stays with Charlotte. Once you're over the age of 35, taking out a pension plan starts to get much more difficult for the simple reason that you start to get listless, can't see the point in life and suffer from periods of inexplicable depression. I think that both Simon and Charlotte would be wise to consider personal single company medium index tracker fund follow-on schemes, if nothing else because they're so simple. These schemes offer both variable below-the-line all-share running yields combined with higher unit fixed derivative bonus options, which are guaranteed ISA compatible until 2003 for savers who pay more than 33% of their net tax bundle, either at the higher rate or above it.
Sunday format. Subtext.
One in every 15 people between the ages of 19 and 34 in Britain is a stand-up comedian. And last year, we spent £8 billion on croissants. Two facts from Tom Buskett and Emma Trout's excellent new Reference Points, Viking £12.95, out this week.
In 1988, Patrick Cutt sold his flat, drove to Zagreb in an ageing Leyland Sherpa, and bought 5,000 Bakelite showerheads, then worth virtually nothing. At the time, as always in stories like this, people thought he'd gone mad. The difference in this case is that he had, and today, with the showerhead still worth nothing, he lives on his own in a telephone box near Cardiff. Verity Hampton's surrealistically beautiful adaptation of Howard Barker's narrative poem, based on his life, is in preview at the Royal Court from Thursday.
Against all odds, the pencil is making a comeback, and not before time, if you listen to Vernon Plowright of the pressure group Graphiting Back, launched...
Could do better. Clodagh Williams offers a midterm report on the state of Britain's schools.
The average German teenager can design and assemble a light aircraft by the age of 16, whilst 3 out of 5 British 16-year-olds are still only 14. By the age of 15, most French school children are at home with the fundamentals of particle acceleration, whereas most British 15-year-olds are simply at home. But what do these comparisons tell us? For Ted Beard, Professor of Political Sociology at the University of Weston-super-Mare, arbitrary comparisons between educational standards in different countries and cultures are of very little value.
It's rather like trying to compare the physical attributes of males with those of females, only not so much fun.
He has just completed the most comprehensive independent study ever attempted of the nation's educational attainment, which is why his marriage has broken up.
The truth is that standards in Britain today are higher than they have ever been. We found that in 1978, for instance, 6 out of 10 school leavers in the Bournemouth area thought that Bournemouth was in Dorset instead of Hampshire. And these days, of course, it is.
And yet, a recent survey by the CBI reveals that 5 out of 10 graduates applying for junior management positions were incapable of interpreting even the simplest statistical data. Worse still, so were the other 5. If you were to go to most schools and colleges in this country...
Contemporaneities. Good things. Holidays. Sleep. Tax cuts. Friendship. Winning the lottery. Flowers. Birth. Clothes. Fine wine. Freedom.
Bad things. 9 to 5. Insomnia. Tax rises. Murder. Being mugged. Dust. Death. Cold snaps. Meths. Captivity. Steve Maddock.
It's Saturday and I'm shopping in my local Waitrose. I usually make a longer trip to Sainsbury's, but tonight my task's a little more urgent. I don't like football, but I've promised to watch the match this evening with Douglas. Douglas is the brother of Philippa, my new girlfriend. And he wears a leather jacket with Raiders written on the back in brown suede. What about these? Asks Douglas. He points to a plastic shelf. Several cans of lager stand in rows, their steely surfaces glimmering in the neon lights. Do you think these are too pricey? He's looking at me. I can tell he expects an answer. No, I say. I think they'll be fine. Douglas hands the cardboard packet to me and I place it in the wire cage of my shopping basket. We wait at the checkout. We don't talk. No one talks. The checkout girl seems bored, and I can't help wondering to myself how much she gets paid. $14.98. The checkout girl's looking at me. Douglas is looking at me. Well, I look at my wallet. I pull out a ticket stub for the Everyman Arts Cinema in Camden. I look at Douglas. Douglas looks at the girl. The girl looks at Douglas, who looks at me again. Sorry, I say. Then, after a moment, maybe we should watch the game sober.
Angus Wilson is on holiday.
Whatever happened to the idea of bright young things? In the 80s, they were bright, they were young, and they had things. But where are they in 95? And most important of all, what are they wearing?
Zoe Cusp,
above left,
28, worked as a picture researcher for the Prattler before starting her own photographic agency.
In my world, you need to have a good eye for the images which have the potential to become the defining icons for the coming weekend. But above all, you need lots of energy. I like to be as anonymous as possible, which is why I shave my head and only ever wear black.
Jacket by Big Black Jacket Company, £440. Black skirt by Alberto Leggi, £210. Both available from Inverse Reflex, London.
Guy Stubble,
below par,
37, set up his own design agency 3 years ago and created the sets for the BBC's hugely successful classic serial Middlebrow last year.
Middlebrow was very good for me because I became famous and went to lots of parties. Going to lots of parties was good for me because I got to do some terrific drugs. And nowadays I value my privacy and my four-year-old son Harry more than anything else. The other day he asked me if he could have a ponytail, so I gave him mine.
Jacket by Rusty Nail Clothing Company, £520. Shirt by Ralph Cheeseburger, £90. Both available from Converse Perplex, London. Wet look trousers by accident.
Health yourself. This week, Dr. Jonathan Bulford on why backs can be a pain.
It's estimated that back pain costs the nation some £20 billion a year in lost man-hours, sickness benefit and NHS bills. Or to put it another way, if we could eliminate back problems, we could afford to build specially equipped orthopaedic unit in every hospital in the country. Although then, of course, there wouldn't be any point in doing that. In many ways, the back functions as the backbone of the human body. It houses the spinal cord, which passes thousands of tiny neural impulses in both directions every second, if you're a member of Bupa. And it is the vital link between our shoulders and our waists. Without it, a whole range of human activities, which we hardly even notice at all, like sex in my wife's case, would become extraordinarily complicated. And yet, most of us subject our backs to constant mistreatment. If you're like me, then the chances are that you sit badly, walk badly, and have three children. But there's a great deal that we can do to prevent damage occurring to our backs and to help cure damage if it does occur. It's unnatural to keep the back in the same position for more than a few minutes at a time. If you watch monkeys climbing trees, for instance, you'll get a very sore neck. So it's important to make a conscious effort.
The week ahead, Television.
Monday, 9 till 10, ITV. Prime Crackling. A welcome return for the po-faced, balding, lonely, chain-smoking police surgeon played by Tony Slattery. Here he is caught in a moral no-man's land as a routine autopsy on a bent colleague leads to suggestions of glue-sniffing at the highest levels in the Met.
8.30 to 9, BBC Two, Second Sight. Responsible for some of the most challenging and innovative TV journalism in recent months. For this, programme researcher Ben Goulding passed himself off as an incontinent lift attendant trying to find work and lodgings in central London. Deeply bleak.
11.15 to 01.50, BBC Two, Tokyo Autumn. First small screen showing for Katayama Tsujikiri's 1950s masterpiece of love, disappointment, death, joy, death, hope and death. Shown here in letterbox format as part of BBC Two's Wandering Subtitles season.
Tuesday.
Wherever you break down in the UK, we can reach you quickly from just £15 per month. Bupa. If you're about to lose it in a big way, better to do it privately.
Going loco. In the Living Travel tabloid pull-out feature supplement section, this week's alliterative train journey is from Kidderminster to Kiev. Jenny Gould found herself in the vanguard in more ways than one. Don't understand that.
A cold, wet January morning on Kidderminster Station isn't exactly the start that comes to mind for one of life's great journeys, so we set off on a pleasant early summer's afternoon in June. For the first 5 minutes of the journey to Worcester, it was all red brick. We were in a tunnel. Then it was tiny back gardens, washing lines and patios, shabby, untidy and often tarted up. Very reminiscent of Philip Larkin, except that he wasn't very often tarted up. Then suddenly it was all grass and trees and sky and river. We'd been derailed. It was nearly 10 o'clock as we slid slowly into platform 9 of London's Euston Station, due to partial brake failure. The next leg of the journey was to Calais, where we boarded the train that was to take us the rest of the 1,800 miles across two continents and three time zones to Kiev. We were shown to our berths, which were smaller than we'd been hoping, but then we'd been hoping that they'd be absolutely massive. By the time the sun came up, it was already light, and we were speeding through open countryside. My fellow travellers were as diverse a collection of people as one could wish to meet in terms of age, gender and appearance, though most of them came from Berkshire. John, from Reading, was pursuing what he described as an illicit 17-year love affair with the Ukraine, though it later transpired that this was a coded way of referring to an illicit affair with a 17-year-old Ukrainian. It just wasn't very well coded. There were Rita and Donald from just outside Aldershot. Donald had originally proposed to Rita on this very same train journey 7 years ago and had become obsessed with recreating the whole experience as accurately as possible. A feel-good story, if ever there was one. Though, a feel-bad story for Donald, since she refused him this time, too. By now, we were almost...
Confidence and success through word power.
Have you ever noticed that the people who make the biggest impression and enjoy the greatest both success socially and at work are those with a good command of the English language? Do you ever find yourself lost for just the right phrase when it really matters, really? Since the dawn of the times, man has almost known that words are some of the most powerful tools at his disposition. Just as it is in the world of nature, the capacitance of speech which has enhanced man from the rest of creation, so in the world of the human world it is the facilitation of words which distinguishes the distinguished man from the indistinct. The good news is that ability with words is a skill like any other word. It can be acquired, and radically it can be improved also. Now, from the USA, comes a...
Get a life. This week, the top 10 list of Marks & Spencer's hypermarkets. 1. Camberley, just off Junction 4 of the M3.
Really quite tastefully done T-shirts with those sort of arty print things on the front. Just absolutely brilliant, tally.
2. Reigate, Junction 8, M25.
Terrific chili and red and...
So it's important to change your posture once every 5 minutes, even if it's only to touch your toes if your job involves standing up for long periods of time, or standing up if your job involves touching your toes for long periods of time. Orthopedists continually tell us that good posture is important. Well, that's all very well, of course, but what exactly is an orthopedist? Well, an orthopedist is some sort of a doctor. As for good posture, there are a number of very simple exercises we can all do. The simplest is perhaps to try standing naturally in the middle of an average-sized room. But then, this is probably so simple it isn't all that much use. The basic problem is that the spine wasn't designed to carry the weight which we now ask it to carry, especially those very fat people. That's one of the reasons why we often advise people who are suffering from severe back pain to lie absolutely flat for a period of time. And the other reason is that it hurts like hell when they stand up. These days, though, as in so many areas of medicine, traditional theories about...
The arts this week.
Cover story. Giles McElhoney reviews the best of this week's listings magazines. In short...
The condensed guide to going out this week.
Friday. The Let's Talk Art season continues with a lecture by Jeremy Brass, motoring correspondent of the Sunday Format. Repetitive, dull and unimaginative. The state of British sitcom. Don't miss...
The alternative bird table exhibition at the Conway Hall, London WC1.
Innovative and traditional bird tables from around the world, challenging our preconceptions of the man-bird relationship. Thursday.
Let's Talk Arts. The season continues with a lecture by the Sunday Format's wine critic, Dominic Strangeworthy. British sitcom. Repetitive, unimaginative and dull.
In the new Sporters Arts section, football. Why England will never win the World Cup again.
Win a free armpit massage holiday in Tuscany. Turn to page 17.
Page 7. In-depth looks at national embarrassment. The state of British sitcom. Unimaginative, dull and repetitive.
In the new Sporters Cultural Fabric section, football. How England can win the World Cup again.
The food supplement.
Praise be to the lard. Luke Johnston makes a greaseproof case for the much-maligned kitchen staple.
At last, it's safe to admit it. For Proust, it was the Madeleine cake. For E.M. Forster, it was the smell of new-mown grass. For me, it's lard. Childhood was, of course, composed of nothing but Sundays, and to this day the lasting memory of my mother, despite the fact that she was a prominent High Court judge, is of a mixing bowl and a haze of flour. And then there was that magical block of white stuff, at once solid and yet malleable, but...
Bill Buckley's gamesmanship.
Lateral thinking. A lives at number 35. B lives at number 53. C lives next door to E, and E used to live next to B, but now lives abroad. Why?
Relative thinking. John's brother's youngest sister-in-law marries Jane's eldest stepsister by marriage, and Jane's...
Cryptic crossword, set by Euripides. In this week's puzzle, the third letter of each clue is deliberately wrong, and by using the code contained in the odd-numbered clue...
An airing cupboard of my own. This week, Marcus Rolfe.
Marcus Rolfe, design analyst and consultant, spends most of his time these days in a 17th-century barn in rural Berkshire, which he has tastefully converted into a 16th-century barn in rural Berkshire. To look at his sharply chiselled features and easy urbanity, you wouldn't think that he was one of six children, son of an alcoholic Irish labourer, born and brought up in the East End of London. And you'd be right. His father was a trading standards officer in Stockport, and Rolfe went up from his local grammar school to Cambridge in the late 60s, where he read cross-legged for a year and a half before dropping out to go to Hornsey College of Art. He regards his airing cupboard as one of his life's important investments. The heavy doors are of polished Tibetan mountain oak, a present from the sculptor Philip Heron, with whom he used to share naive foundation year students at Hornsey. The pastel green kimono dressing gown, which has pride of place on the shelf over the imposing Jugendstil hot water tank, is of finest silk, made by an order of Trappist monks in a monastery high up in the French Pyrenees.
It was a present from Xavier for my 45th birthday last year. We made a special trip to choose it ourselves, a difficult process because they're a silent order, so we had to communicate in sign language. And first of all, we bought a tractor by mistake. I wear it only when something especially significant happens. I wore it when Yolanda, our second child, was born, also when she was conceived.
Rolfe first met Xavier when they slept together. He was working on
Tuesday, 9.30 to 10.40, BBC One, Morose. A new series of cases for the middle-aged, much-divorced, solitary, alcoholic, plainclothes police photographer played by Vic Reeves. This episode finds him in an ethical dilemma as a routine photograph sparks allegations of widespread cross-dressing amongst senior ranks.
9.30 to 10.40, BBC One, Corrected Vision. Reporter Adam Lawson disguised himself for 2 months as a dog in inner-city Leeds. For those of us who thought that the 80s ended when the 90s began, his report is by turns worrying, troubling and disquieting.
Sticky, and at the same time so satisfyingly slippery that when sliced into slabs according to the calibrations marked on the side of the packet, ah yes, remember those, it fell absolutely cleanly to the knife and slithered majestically off the paper into the flour and eggs below, like an ocean liner's slow progress down the slipway into its natural element.
It was almost dark as dusk fell on the first day and we pulled into Frankfurt. By now, a real sense of esprit de corps had developed between this small group of people thrown together by accident and circumstance, due partly to the romantic sense of a shared progress across a European landmass which stretched away from us into infinite distance, and partly to the fact that two of the toilets were out of action.
105 to 250, Channel 4. The buttocks of an undertaker. Uncut on British television for the first time, Peter Greengage's brilliant 1984 film, now generally acknowledged as a defining moment in recent British cinema history. Quentin Crisp and John Gielgud play blind bisexual twins in 17th century Prague, each obsessed with the idea of impregnating each other with music by Michael Hyman. A coruscating and visually stunning study of the complex relationship between death, lust, decay, buttocks, death, loss of lust, art and death. Shown here as part of Channel 4's Buttocks Week.
When you've selected the three books you'd like people to think you've read, simply fill in the form below and send it to The Thick Spine Book Club, Free Postmodernism, Bleak House, Swan's Way North and South, Middlemarch.
Krakow came and went, and then came again due to faulty points. This was my first visit to Poland. I had imagined that it would be a mountainous country with huge glaciers, hot springs and hidden tropical valleys, just as I had imagined Suffolk to be shortly before my first course of therapy. We were in Russia before we knew it, though of course we didn't know that.
We slowed for the last time, and the splendours of Kiev's ancient...
Beginning to understand that back pain is actually a problem of perception. Conventional medical education has produced generations of doctors trained to see patients in this condition as people with back trouble, rather than what they in fact are, which is people with pain trouble.
Next week sees the appearance of two new additions to the cookery shelves, The Lard's Supper by Libby Dilly and The Lard Moves in 101 Mysterious Ways by Jilly Philly. Both packed with inventive and surprising things to do with lard, and both, incidentally, with a foreword by Felicity Kendall.
The Samoans believe that the pampas grass does not blow in the wind, it is the wind which blows in the pampas grass. This shift in perception isn't always easy to achieve for those of us living in the West.
Next week, front pain.
Since we're both so busy professionally, it's easy to lose contact with the dignity which the everyday simple tasks confer on one. That's why the airing cupboard is so important to both of us. We wanted a space where the interface between work and living was less acutely drawn.
Does your memory let you down? In social situations, at work, academically, or in social situations? Mine used to, but not anymore. It used to, though. Now, following research carried out in Sweden, there's a simple and, something to do with numbers. Or those... Does your memory let you down?
My favourite is a stunning apricot and coriander oatmeal parkin from 101 Mysterious Ways, which left me literally speechless for several hours.
The heavy worsted bath mat airing on the lowest shelf has an interesting history. It was designed by Japanese artist Yuko Yamasushi and carries one of her own designs, representing the blossoming of happiness in austerity.
Andrew Masterson's latest novel, The Bloodhounds of Elfinhead, is published by Virago on December.
They bought their first Yamasushi face cloth 7 years ago and now have one of the largest collections of her work in the country.
We're not objects people, but we do buy bathroom linen. Yuko gave me that print for my 45th birthday last year.
And then it was time to say our goodbyes in the clear Ukrainian air. Kidderminster only a distant memory, before going our separate ways.
I now don't work on Sundays, apart from television and speaking engagements, and I feel that somehow it's important to spend time in the bathroom.
As this frail travelling coincidence and the network of friendships which it had engendered began to loosen, our thoughts were already tinged with the sadness of what might have happened. Pointless and silly, really, particularly since we were all booked into the same hotel, and a good deal of what might have happened did.
Jenny Gould. Next week we begin a new series of assonant train journeys when Patrick Vaughan goes from Cumbria to Umbria.
Steve Maddock.
Barry.
Above right. No, we couldn't believe it either.
Angus Wilson is on holiday. The week ahead. Ahead. Television. A cup of something hot.
Next week sees the appearance of two new additions to the cookery shelves.
Enormously liberating.
The Lard's Supper by Libby Dilly.
Does your memory let you down?
Cover story. Thrilled to death. Is media treatment of human...
Travel. 51.
Tax cuts.
Bile.
Or Marmite buttocks.
Boots.
Unhappy.
Good.
Bottom right. Love line. Left behind.
Graphiting.
I like to read the contents page last.
The Sunday format starred Alexander Armstrong, Ben Miller, Rebecca Front, Simon Greenall, Cyril Jenkins and Chris Langham.